Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone, from wherever you're joining us, and welcome to today's webinar titled Strategic Approaches to Age-Related Metabolic Insufficiency and Transition into Dementia Syndrome, featuring Dr. Dennis Turner, Professor of Neurosurgery at Duke University. Today, he will delve into dementia syndrome, the metabolic changes that occur, and the importance of proper physiological monitoring of animal models. I wanted to take a moment to thank our partners at the American Physiological Society and the sponsor for this event, Kent Scientific, for making it all possible. I'm now excited to welcome Dr. Turner. Hi, Dennis. Welcome to the floor. You can take it away whenever you're ready.
Okay. All right. So, hello. So, I'm Dennis Turner. I work at Duke University. I've been doing cellular neurophysiology for over 50 years now, and I've been interested in aging for years, and so and then Alzheimer's for about 10 years, particularly kind of metabolic aspects of Alzheimer's. These are my disclosures. I have no conflicts of interest for this. An email if anybody wants to send me an email, and then we just start off. So. Particularly what I'm interested in is brain substrate supply, and then what does the brain do with that substrate supply? One of the particular topics I'm interested in is neurovascular coupling, and this is a process where blood flow changes depending upon neuronal demand and delivers more oxygen, glucose, or other substrates into the brain. Obviously, age and disease can significantly reduce the vascular supply to the brain through vascular pathology, and also influence the reactivity of the blood vessels, where they do not respond as well to the neuronal demand. This can lead to at least a transient or continuing deficit in the neurovascular response and lead to problems with substrate supply, often at the times when neurons need it most. This critical distribution of supply across the blood-brain barrier can obviously result in neuronal damage. We see that with stroke. If it's chronic and kind of at a level below a stroke, we would call this metabolic insufficiency. This has been a long-standing theory in Alzheimer's disease, as well as a problem potentially in aging. So when we think about the brain, then on the left, we have to, I'll take an arrow here, then we have to consider the blood vessels themselves providing the substrate to the brain. And so that's modified both by systemic factors like blood pressure, as well as, of course, by the viability of the blood vessels themselves and their reactivity. Then oxygen can diffuse across. Glucose has to be mediated by a transporter across the blood-brain barrier. And as it crosses the blood-brain barrier, then there can be substrate limitations because of whether the glucose transporter is present or not. Once into the brain, then neurons take it up, as well as astrocytes and glial cells, and there's an area of diffusion within the extracellular space for both substrate as well as, of course, byproducts like lactate and glutamate. And then the final chain is emptying of the brain. So the brain extracellular space drains into spinal fluid, either at the subarachnoid space level or at the ventricular level. And that's called recently the lymphatic system or drainage of the brain, and clearance can be a big problem in some entities. So while O2 can diffuse freely and likewise CO2 backwards to exit the brain, glucose and ketone bodies, the two main substrates, require facilitated transport, using transport mechanisms across the blood-brain barrier. The ARTIC diagram on the right shows that there's a very complex set of mediators which actually tell the blood vessels to dilate or increase the blood flow, which you can see is like nitric oxide, potassium itself, which is mediated through potassium channels in the blood vessels, as well as many other compounds, both from directly from neurons like nitric oxide, as well as from astrocytes. And these influence parasites at the capillary level. And then many of the parasite changes are mediated upstream to arterioles to cause a vasodilation. So when we think of what neurons need metabolism for? Well, they need it for energy provision for ion pumps because of the very active ionic movements associated with action potentials and with activity, but also for ongoing cell maintenance. The systemic supply provides O2, glucose, or ketone bodies. And then, like I said, the glucose transporters are across the blood-brain barrier and astrocytes, but there's a different one for entry into neurons. Likewise, ketones require monocarboxylate transporters, both one at the blood-brain barrier and two, and these have different affinities for pyruvate and lactate when neurons are actually taking these substances into the cell. And this is from Atwell from 10 years ago, just kind of indicating that we have both catabolic pathways, which generate heat energy and secondary byproduct of heat, as well as anabolic pathways. In general, neurons tend to be more catabolic and astrocytes tend to be more anabolic, but that's not a fixed rule. And astrocytes are intricately linked to neuronal function, providing many of the molecules, for example, such as glutamate, back to neurons. And then the upper left drawing shows just a general diagram of cellular metabolic regulation, with calcium entry being very, very important. And then also the citric acid cycle shown below, with calcium regulating many of the critical enzymatic functions to generate ATP through the electron transport chain. These are typically well described, and I won't go into these in detail, other than what potential changes might occur during aging. So during aging, complex 1 has most of its enzymes transcribed through the mitochondrial DNA, and mitochondrial DNA can accumulate errors. And so aged mitochondria tend to be less sensitive to complex 1 inhibitors, such as rotenone, that can generate more free radicals that are shown as ROS in the diagram, as well as cause further mitochondrial DNA damage. So there may be a limitation with aging. So that gets us into theories of aging. There's many, and many apply, for example, telomeres to cells which divide constantly, whereas neurons, of course, are typically post-mitotic, except for the minor number of stem cells present. So programmed evolution implies something kind of like puberty or menopause, where there's a predetermined time for cellular function to end via apoptosis, much like during development, when many cells do not find targets and hence undergo apoptosis during later development to reduce the number of neurons, and that may continue for the rest of our life. There's also wear and tear thoughts, that accumulation of somatic and mitochondrial DNA damage and protein damage, which may or may not be correctable, eventually leads to cell death. Another theory is free radical theory, where there's considerably induced damage via reactive oxygen species. It's very important for mitochondria in the cell to buffer these through a number of buffering mechanisms, but these buffering mechanisms may fade as the cell gets older. Calcium theory implies that we have a change in calcium buffering, switching from organelles such as endoplasmic reticulum, but to flood mitochondria, which can really upset a considerable amount of metabolic regulation. And then a really good question about aging that's been around for years has been, is Alzheimer's disease just an accelerated form of aging, or is there more specific pathology associated with it? And we'll talk a little bit about more in a minute. And this just gives a diagram of potentially aging changes, with enhanced calcium affecting both cytoplasmic regulation here through a number of calcium sensitive mechanisms, also affecting mitochondrial regulation through loss of control of some of the critical mitochondrial enzymes with an elevated calcium level, as well as the loss of complex 1 through the miscoding in the mitochondrial DNA. And then also regulation through the cytosol and through other organelles, such as PARP activation and DNA mutation and NAD depletion. And so there's an increased free radical. So many different ways that neurons can go bad. And fortunately, we have considerable buffering available for many of these to avoid dysfunction within neurons. And so neuroactivity, of course, requires significant injury for ATPases to maintain sodium and potassium gradients. Synthesis of neurotransmitters itself, for example, dopamine, can also generate considerable reactive oxygen species. So there's a fine line between maintaining sufficient neural activity to overall keep the brain functioning, as well as lowering the reactive oxygen species burden. So what's happened over the past many years is the idea of reduced caloric intake, which can help keep the brain functioning, but perhaps reduce the reactive oxygen species burden and then help neurons live longer. So that gets into the idea of caloric restriction can enhance longevity in many species. It's not been tested perhaps for long enough in humans, but there's still a number of advocates of this, and I'll give a chart on the next slide. And one of the mechanisms may include switching to ketone metabolic use rather than glucose in mitochondria to reduce some of the reactive oxygen species. This enhanced lifespan with caloric restriction has been tested in many species. It's typically easier to show in those with shorter lifespans, such as lower mammals, for example, rather than humans. And it's unclear if it's related to decreased neural activity as a potential contributor to enhanced longevity, decreased reactive oxygen species function, or changes in mitochondrial function. This is a chart from Mattson, where he details many of the potential effects of caloric restriction. And then he has a really good diagram of potential ways that in people we can lead to caloric restriction with basically a four month long transition into caloric restriction, where by the end it's mostly ketones feeding the brain then. And this gets back to fasting as a very traditional form of enhancing mental clarity, as it's present in many cultures, where fasting for a few days may, by forcing the brain to use ketone bodies, may be able to increase how clear your thinking is. And so this is a projected potential a way to incorporate intermittent fasting, though it has yet to be really demonstrated that it's increases lifespan in humans. And so we get the concept of successful aging. This has been around since the 90s. For example, the National Aging Institute has had cohorts of super agers, which they've been studying for years to try and understand why some people live so much longer than others. Clearly, neurons continue to die slowly as we get older. But if it's successful aging, the remaining cells may show both dendritic and axonal hypertrophy. We have an older paper from 20 years ago showing dendritic hypertrophy and also axon collateral sprouting. This implies resilience and the ability to compensate with maintained neural activity to really maintain the function of the organ over time. Also requires, of course, good vascular supply and the systemic aspects to be intact as well. For example, blood pressure and other aspects as well as the blood vessels. There's clearly a balance between sufficient neural activity to initiate this compensation and to maintain the compensation, as well as too much activity that can damage cells through reactive oxygen species. And it's very unclear where this balance lies, but clearly in some individuals, they have reached that balance for the idea of superaging or maintaining a very long lifespan. And so compensation may maintain the overall brain function as long as pathology doesn't intervene, such as stroke, for example. So we have various types of metabolism, such as glycolysis, which provides a lot of the ATPase energy in a submembrane location, aerobic glycolysis providing the critical precursor pyruvate, and then, of course, oxidative phosphorylation of pyruvate in the mitochondria is very efficient. There's still a concept in the brain, similar to muscles, that we may have lactate-releasing cells, such as astrocytes, confer lactate across to neurons, which are lactate consuming cells. And so this is still very controversial, called a lactate shuttle, something I've studied in the past, and I tend to support it by and large for metabolism. For example, in complete lack of glucose, astrocytes can release substrate through glycogen and support neurons for at least a half hour to 45 minutes. And so this is one example of the lactate shuttle working, where the astrocytes provide a critical substrate to support brain function for a period of time in presence of hypoglycemia. And so the way that we measure metabolism in people, you can do in vivo respirometry, where you can calculate CO2 utilization, CO2 production. This is done frequently in athletes, and you get an energy and respiratory quotient. And in vivo values tend to relate more to muscle metabolism, with brain as only a small contributor to the metabolism. And this is done for training for most competitive athletes now. In general, there's a decreased oxidative capacity in aging. And the question is this due to changes in mitochondrial regulation, mitochondrial biogenesis and turnover, PET studies in patients with oxygen 15 also show a declining cerebral metabolic rate of O2 with aging. And then in our in vitro example, or in vivo in animals, we can also use a seahorse analysis, both for cells and slices, to study very quantitatively the balance of glycolysis and oxidative metabolism. And so we'll talk quite a bit about in vivo physiology, but first, alternatives to in vivo physiology. So for years, I've studied metabolism in brain slices, such as hippocampal or cortical slices. And there you can fix the substrate levels, but it's an artificial supply. So we tend to provide, for example, 50 to 95% O2 versus the 21% O2 that's provided to the brain normally, just because there's considerable gradients within tissue slices due to both diffusion and neuronal activity. So if you supply 21 to 30% oxygen to most slices, then the interior is very anoxic. And so you have to provide a bit more to be able to provide at the very interior, middle of the slice, sufficient oxygen. Likewise, there's glucose gradients within the tissue, so you have to supply at the edges excess glucose, i.e. 10 millimolar, to provide sufficient for the interior of the slice. So this approach is very interesting because of the artificial nature of the substrates. You can separate substrate supply and vascular pathology from what we consider to be innate cell metabolism. So for example, if you change the number of vascular collaterals in stroke-prone rats or stroke-prone mice, the actual cells in the brain may have a similar intrinsic metabolic function in spite of the fact that you're taking those cells or that tissue slice from a stroke-prone animal. And so by separating it out, you can look at more intrinsic aging changes. And so in brain slices, for example, we can limit then either O2 or glucose separately, very different from what a stroke causes in the brain, where both are limited at the same time. And then we can show what happens, for example, to oxidative metabolism. So in rat-aged brain slices, if you reduce glucose and the cells are maintained, then the cells automatically switch from glycolysis to more oxidative metabolism to get along with the reduced glucose levels. In age slices, they are not able to do this as well. And so we see what we consider to be an increased reliance on glycolysis in aged animals because they aren't able to switch effectively. And so aged brains also show changes with hypoxia, where because of the enhanced reactive oxygen species, they show much more NADH hyperoxidation after even short periods of hypoxia. And I'll give some examples of that. On the left is the gradient of oxygen as measured with a small oxygen electrode within a tissue slice, showing a large amount of decrease. And then if you have an impaired slice, you can see there's much less neuronal utilization with, for example, the black dots up here, as compared to an intact slice with cells actively metabolizing and utilizing oxygen. And then On the right, this is the hyperoxidation that's noticed after even a short hypoxia period as measured with NADH imaging, which you can see whereas the oxygen tends to recover. This goes along with increased cell death. This is an example from Galeffi 2015, where we reduced the glucose in aged rat slices down to 2.5 from 10. And you notice that the field EPSP drops here and then recovers when we restore the media. But in aged animals, aged slices, they do not switch to enhanced oxygen utilization like young animals do. So they have much less efficient metabolism when forced to switch to oxidative phosphorylation, implying that the regulation of mitochondria or the actual mitochondria themselves have an inability to turn on with the reduced glucose. So when we think about those are what we would consider successful aging, in other words, aged models from aged rats, aged mice. And for years, there was a question, is aging alone a really good model for Alzheimer's disease? And clearly with Alzheimer's disease, such as an animal model, we need a comparison of age-matched controls to either human or animal models just to see what is the baseline age changes in metabolism versus the additional changes that we can see with Alzheimer's. There can be what we consider to be graded metabolic demands in both people as well as in animal models. So, for example, you can do direct electrical stimulation, sensory inputs, which cause an innate metabolic change, as well as some severe metabolic change, which is putting potassium on the brain, causing a spreading depression. We call this a very strong demand since most cells depolarize and there's significant ATPS pump activity required to enable repolarization. And so the question is, can in vivo, can supply match neuronal demand, particularly when there's a strong metabolic need for significant new supply coming into the brain? And so for a lot of these studies, then we have switched over the last 10 years to in vivo metabolism studies. These are invasive experiments in animals, which require sort of humane, reliable, and reproducible anesthesia, often done with inhalation, such as isoflurane, or with other injectable anesthesias. Clearly, to accomplish that, you need very good vital sign recording. And so we estimate, for example, pulse ox using a pulse ox device, as well as blood pressure. These can be estimated non-invasively or invasively. And then also respirations, and either with spontaneous respirations or with induced respirations through a respirator. Our preference for these invasive experiments has been spontaneous respirations, which result in a slightly higher systemic PCO2. We can estimate cerebral blood flow by laser Doppler, laser speckle, which is equivalent to the human CT perfusion now done for most strokes. Neuronal activity through either a mild or a strong demand induces enhanced cerebral blood flow or hyperemia. And we can do various kinds of demand inductions to be able to estimate how the cells and body may the brain may respond. And so we can measure neurovascular coupling and response to neuronal demand using various kinds of blood flow measures and compare that to the baseline resting level. And so in vivo then, we can estimate neurovascular coupling, substrates under general anesthesia. Unfortunately, most anesthetic drugs can interfere with vascular responses. For example, isoflurane is neuroprotective, whereas propofol and chloralose tend not to be. And so you have to be careful about your anesthesia, like for example, stroke models, to be able to make sure that the neuroprotection doesn't overlap or prevent your induction of stroke. And then vital sign monitoring is very critical. For example, we use temperature pads, pulse, respirations, blood pressure, and pulse oximetry routinely for these kind of in vivo experiments. And then this is just a picture. So you can see kind of a rough idea that deep inside there is a very, very small mouse with multiple electrodes and imaging placed into it. And then the actual view under the microscope is this view here, where you can see burr holes, laser Doppler monitors, the exposed skull. But fortunately in mice, you could do most of the monitoring across the skull. Whereas in this animal, we have bilateral intracranial glass electrodes to be able to assess what's going on both sides as an SD occurs through a small burr hole at the front. And then on the right here is when we're doing imaging with various kinds of light sensitive to hemoglobin, then you can see the laser light induced by the laser speckle, which we block out, and then also the rest of the brain. So we can watch like spreading depression, for example. And then you can see the entire approach here, as well as the monitoring, where we have on this animal, two blood flow electrodes, two glass recording electrodes, as well as direct imaging with intrinsic optical signals. So this is one kind of approach to what we would consider to be invasive in vivo physiology. So switching to Alzheimer's disease now in people, of course, there's many theories to explain the cell damage and progressive cognitive loss, such as herpes encephalitis, metabolic insufficiency, and inflammation with or plaques and tangles. And clearly these are all being sorted out and make a huge difference as to the potential therapeutic hypotheses. We know a number of risk factors such as education, diet, age, vascular factors, diabetes, activity, APOE4, and many genetic factors, including the very small number of familial Alzheimer's disease. In many studies, low glucose utilization has been demonstrated with FDG PET of the brain, even in early Alzheimer's patients, suggesting that there may be metabolic insufficiency even transiently during high demand periods as potentially one contributing cause for Alzheimer's damage. And so we use an Alzheimer's animal model developed here at Duke with Carol Colton, where she has both a familial APP mutation, but also reduces the mouse inflammatory level of nitric oxide by replacing the mouse NOS2, nitric oxide synthase, with the human NOS2. And this results in human levels of nitric oxide, doesn't take it away, and signaling nitric oxide, such as from neurons to blood vessels, which is through NOS3, is not affected or directly in blood vessels. And so we see preserved neurovascular coupling in this model. And the CVN model shows most of the stigmata of Alzheimer's disease, including age-related plaques, phosphorylated tau, considerable behavior abnormalities. But the advantage of the animal model is that we can study the model at very predictable ages where we know that they will have these stereotypic changes. So for example, there's very severe changes in this mouse model by 36 to 52 weeks. And so one of the projects we did was to analyze neurovascular coupling across aging in response to a strong metabolic demand. The left hand shows the plaques that develop over time. And there's a diagram here showing by 52 weeks, there's very significant plaque accumulation. And the right-hand diagram shows ATH insoluble tau, which also accumulates throughout the hippocampus and neocortex. So we consider this animal model a very good stereotypic model of Alzheimer's. And then we have our in vivo setup, which includes a burr hole to induce potassium spreading depolarization, laser Dopplers, a glass to assess that, glass electrode, and then we induce spreading depolarization, which is this approximately 15 millivolt decrease in extracellular voltage, so we can measure this directly, and then this spreading depolarization induces a significant hyperemia. And in this graph, we show hyperemia, which is the red, in young animals. And then even in the aged control animals, there's an abbreviation of the hyperemia and less duration and height of it. And whereas in the CVN or Alzheimer's model, we see that even early on in middle age, they also show an abbreviated hyperemia, which progressively gets worse, whereas the young animals tend to have a normal hyperemia. What this causes effectively then is a substantial decrease by approximately 150% of blood flow into the brain associated with the strong neuronal demand. So this could be one basis for metabolic insufficiency. So we have reduced premature aging changes in the blood flow response to spreading depolarization. Of course, in aged animals, there also may be abnormal blood vessels and lead to stroke or hemorrhage. These are common in Alzheimer's as well, and that also could worsen the metabolism. And clearly in Alzheimer's, unlike successful aging, there's a considerably reduced ability to compensate to be able to maintain neurons in a healthy state. So we have considerable degeneration of neurons, atrophy, reduced glucose metabolism altogether. And so we tend to call the insufficient metabolism long-term then as coming from a number of factors. Clearly abnormal blood vessels, abnormal blood vessel reactivity, which may limit the response to neuronal demand and may also limit the blood supply coming in. There's a number of changes in the glucose transporters, GLUT1, that also can limit the glucose uptake. So limiting substrate additionally at various what we consider to be serial levels. And then there's decreased glucose utilization can really arise from both factors. And then on top of that, the intrinsic metabolism, where there's less efficient glucose metabolism, may increase the neuronal need for glucose concurrent with the limited supply, resulting in a significant demand-supply mismatch. In other words, the blood vessels may not be able to deliver the necessary substrate. Hence, you could have a chronic cell loss, which is kind of the core theory associated with metabolic insufficiency. However, there's considerable limits to in vivo physiology, and the main reason to study the brain this intensely is to be able to have multiple invasive electrodes. And clearly the awake state is much more difficult to monitor. One can do a window, but you only have non-invasive imaging through that window. In the awake in vivo animal, one could estimate, for example, small blood vessel diameter during skull fixed microscopy in awake behaving animals, but many other ability factors such as, for example, blood flow with laser Doppler, laser speckle cannot be done, at least currently. And so there's kind of an acute where we do invasive physiology with considerable monitoring and many electrodes, whereas on a chronic research basis, windows would be definitely preferable with intermittent evaluation of the animal. And this just shows other things that we can measure in the brain. So for example, this is oxygen transient in response to, you can see the oxygen here where there's a significant oxygen dip. These are 10 micron oxygen electrodes that we can put into the brain. We can do invasive glutamate or glucose as well. This shows also what happens after a stroke where a spreading depolarization can spread into penumbra areas leading to a decreased blood flow rather than a hyperemia. And so all of these then can be factors that are best imaged and best evaluated with an in vivo invasive prep. But at some point that has to be extended to a more chronic preparation as well. So to treat metabolic insufficiency, then there's a number of interesting things that we can do. Obviously you can prevent vascular pathology and stroke by treating hypertension and diabetes. This has worked miraculously for stroke prevention over the last 30 years, as neurologists have really enhanced the ability to treat small vessel as well as large vessel disease. We have one other approach, which is extracranial brain stimulation, which can also enhance blood flow directly, and that's potentially a treatment mechanism. And then if we could enhance parasite or blood vessel response to neuronal demand, we could restore potassium channel function in parasites, which might enhance neurovascular coupling. And then if we can improve glucose uptake at the blood-brain barrier, there's a number of compounds now that can do this. And then we could also enhance metabolism at the mitochondrial level. This is a summary chart where we can go by different mechanisms. For example, glucagon-like peptide, which is currently commonly being used for diabetes, may also enhance glucose uptake at the blood-brain barrier, and this is in trials for Alzheimer's. Even standard diabetic and insulin treatments may enhance, as well as ghrelin agonist. And then there's not a human approach yet for enhancing clearance of byproducts from the brain. And then there's many alternatives, such as the ketogenic diet, the intermittent fasting, and then other kinds of precursors, such as oxaloacetate, which could provide an alternative mitochondrial substrate. And then we have things that can directly enhance mitochondrial functioning, for example, nicotinamide, which we've studied quite a bit in hypoxia, as well as carbonic acid, acetazolamide, which has not been tested yet. There's an element of hyperexcitability with Alzheimer's, so anticonvulsants have been tested as well, particularly early in Alzheimer's when there can be an increased seizure frequency. And then various aspects of cholinergic norepinephrine, changing the vascular tone, as well as, of course, sirtuins and circadian rhythm dysfunction. Many of these have been or are being tested in human trials to supplement many of the other more traditional approaches, such as decreasing plaques, for example. And this is an example where we have a slightly different prep, and again, in a mouse with extracranial stimulating or transcranial electrical stimulation, where you can see rapid changes in blood flow associated with this stimulation and actually calculate a dose response curve. So I have another grant on pursuing this as a potential Alzheimer's treatment. So in summary then, to understand dynamic brain metabolism really requires what we consider to be a physiological real-time analysis of supply, demand, and clearance. So we need to know and measure the supply, often done with direct blood flow measurements. We need to estimate the demand at the neuronal level, often through physiologic techniques, and then the clearance, what happens to byproducts, how do they get in, and then what are alternative kinds of supply, such as ketones versus glucose. Clearly, there's a dynamic balance between brain metabolic supply and demand, and one needs to explore this transient metabolic insufficiency, whereas, for example, spinal fluid levels are more of a chronic kind of insufficiency if you're measuring glucose or metabolites. And then it's very important to integrate across the spectrum of cellular utilization, both within neurons and astrocytes, with neurovascular supply limitations, since these clearly are synergistic factors in separating out aging from Alzheimer's disease. And then I have a number of excellent research collaborators. So for the aging study, Kelly Foster, Francesca Galeffi, Gauri Propley, Matthew Sangrove, and Pavan Shetty have all been carefully involved and have multiple published studies. For my more recent Alzheimer's model studies, Carol Colton is a PhD in neurology here at Duke, and she developed and provides the various CVN animals as well as all of the other subtypes. And then Simone Dagan is a veterinary physiologist, and Yufeng is now a research scholar, and then have worked considerably with Ulrika Hoffman, who's now moved to Texas. And then with the extracranial stimulation, we happen to have two experts here at Duke. Steve Schmidt did his PhD on extracranial brain stimulation, and then Anko Paterchev is a world-famous engineer in psychiatry focused on minimally invasive extracranial stimulation. It's an excellent research group. And then these are some of my favorite hiking places whenever I have a chance to get away. And that's the end of the talk.
Okay, great talk. That was really interesting. We have lots of questions to get to. So let's get started. First one here. You mentioned that isoflurane is neuroprotective. Could you elaborate on this, please? You know, examples, mechanism, et cetera.
So isoflurane has been, there's shown to be neuroprotective in stroke models, and there's probably at least 12 articles on this in the last 15 years. And it's neuroprotective through, it enhances blood flow to the brain directly. We see that both in patients as well as in animal models. And so in addition to enhanced blood flow, it tends to help put neurons slightly asleep, which may reduce their ability, for example, to have like spreading depression. And so there's multiple levels at both the blood vessel and the neuron level. And this is one reason why inhalation anesthesia is neuroprotective in patients as well, and one of the most common types of anesthesia used.
Fantastic. Great response. Thank you. Okay, our next one. Does hyperglycemia in type 1 diabetes patients lead to dementia?
It's a very good question. When hyperglycemia is studied in slice models, for example, it's very neuroprotective. So the question is it the hyperglycemia per se that's in the blood, or is it the lack of insulin and other factors associated with the hyperglycemia that really may be loss of neuroprotection? In patients, hyperglycemia is a very bad prognostic factor for stroke, but it's unclear if it's the actual glucose itself or if it's other factors associated with diabetes.
Okay, good response, thank you. Okay, Gail asked another question about the isoflurane. Do you use oxygen or room air? Can you also elaborate on to why you use whichever option?
So we use typically 30% oxygen, but room air is also fine with spontaneous breathing. And we measure the PO2, PCO2 in the system, in the blood, to be able to calibrate those. But either 21 to 30% is fine to avoid hyperoxia.
Fantastic. Okay. Our next question, can we reversibly reduce the neuron's energy demand in a short period to treat the metabolic insufficiency?
It's a great question. That's done for stroke, for example. You can reduce demand through anesthesia. For example, even isoflurane is a stroke treatment in the acute ICU or other drugs such as ketamine, for example. Unfortunately, in an awake person, it's very difficult to reduce the demand because you won't be able to think then. So all of the drugs that reduce demand also tend to be sedating or anesthesia type drugs.
Okay, that makes sense. All right, this question here. Can regular exercise, if started early in life, alleviate the occurrence of dementia? That's an interesting question.
It's a very good question. We have now three articles from the last 4 years on what determines longevity in humans. And these are database studies. And the one simple answer that's come out of all the studies is walking speed. So the faster you walk at any age, the longer you tend to live. It's the best predictive factor. These are published in JAMA, all four of the articles. Excellent database studies. So obviously, if you can walk fast, that means you don't have systemic disease like lung disease. You have the interest in walking, so you don't have dementia. And you also have like good cardiac function as well as body function overall. So it's really the best measure of overall fitness. And clearly, if you're going to walk fast at a later age, you have to walk fast at a young age. So my guess is that exercise is very important. This is obviously emphasized by most longevity, and I think it enhances longevity. Yes.
Wow. Really interesting. I didn't know that. Okay. Our next question is from Alice. Does caloric restriction improve the ability of aged animals to switch from glycolysis to oxidative metabolism?
That's a great question. I honestly don't know. I'd have to go back and look at the Mattson article. And that's one of the large area of studies that have not been well published in terms of the caloric restriction model is to do slices on it or do seahorse analysis.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I just wanted to quickly remind the audience too, you've mentioned a couple articles. I don't know if those exact ones are linked, but there are some handouts under that handouts tab that you can view and download to. Dr. Turner did link a couple, and then there's some interesting ones, other interesting ones as well about Kent Scientific. So, okay, next question here. Your AD, disappeared for me for a moment. Here we go. Your AD mouse model has APP mutation, but not tau protein mutation. You also observe tau tangles in your model. Do you know when the tau tangles start to appear in your model?
Dr. Colton has several articles on that, and these really start to appear about 20, 24 weeks. And it's she views it not necessarily as tangles, but as non-phosphorylated or insoluble tau, which is what's more easily measured. And so you don't need the tau mutation to be able to get it in this kind of model with the reduced nitric oxide levels.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Okay. Let's jump to this question here. Can you discuss how limitations in oxygen supply and mitochondrial function could impact the ability to utilize alternate fuel sources like ketones and lactate?
With ketones, there's still a need for oxidative phosphorylation. It's very hard, unless you have clear hypoxia from a pulmonary source, to really significantly reduce oxygen to the point that mitochondria don't have enough. And you can estimate that with NADH imaging, what is the critically low level of oxygen, and it's probably only 1 or 2%. So room air for us almost always provides sufficient oxygen unless there's some other really large systemic problem. So it's very unusual to see true hypoxia effect. It's really other factors like regulation within the mitochondria that affect oxidative phosphorylation rather than the oxygen level.
Okay, that was a good response. All right, we have a question from Joyce. Can exogenous ketone work as brain energy substrate in the absence of fasting in dementia?
Well, you need to switch out glucose. So there is a ketogenic diet for epilepsy, which does that over a period of time where you have progressively less glucose in your diet and you force the body to become more ketogenic. But intermittent fasting does it better than ketogenic diet. So there's several approaches to that, but you have to reduce your glucose simultaneously with increased ketones.
Okay, that makes sense. John asks, are there and what is the distribution of GLUT2 receptors? Could this be related to the neuroprotective effect of high glucose levels in vitro?
So in vitro, in brain slices, we don't really worry about blood-brain barrier glucose transport through GLUT1. And GLUT2 is more on neurons, and that seems to be present sufficient. So neurons, even aging neurons or from our CVN model, seem to take up glucose very well in vitro slices. So it's more a blood-brain barrier limitation that we would not see in vitro, yeah.
Right, okay. Awesome. Okay, let me see here. When you says, what is the difference between caloric restriction and intermittent fasting? Which one is better for delayed aging or dementia? And if we compare to the keto diet?
I view them all the same. It just, if you measure the level of glucose and the level of ketone bodies, acetoacetate and beta-hydroxybutyrate in the blood, then they all reach the same point. It's just a question of how long one is fasting. So the schedule that Dr. Madsen gives for human caloric restriction is different. So for example, in lower animals, it's really just every other day food. So you fast for 24 hours, then you have some food for 24 hours. So it could be as simple as that. But it's really how much does each alternative approach change the ketone levels and reduce glucose. So that would need to be compared depending on the specific diet, like in a rat model, for example.
Right. Okay. Okay. Yeah, we have lots of great questions. So continue, please, guys, continue to submit them. This is fantastic. Raquel asks, how does sleeping influence aging and dementia? How does not adjusting to the circadian rhythms influence this?
So there's a number of very interesting articles from the last 5 years from Mako Nadergaard on sleeping as being very important for clearing the brain of toxic substances through the glymphatic pathways and into spinal fluid. And so when neurons are less active, then the extracellular space shrinks. And so the body is able to clear the brain much better. And so lack of clearance may enhance toxicity And that's typically done during sleeping or during times of inactivity of the brain. And so sleep is probably very important for clearance and also just reduced neuronal demand. So they have a kind of a time to catch up, as well as things like dreams and many other features associated with sleep.
Interesting. I like that saying, even just for day to day, that sleep clears the, I think it does more than just the toxins and stuff. Mm-hmm. Obviously it resets you and your body and everything. So sleep is very important. Daniel's question says, do changes in the rates of metabolic heat production in the brain parallel the other metabolic changes observed in aging dementia?
That's a great question. So metabolic heat production is related to how much ATP hydrolysis is ongoing. So it just says the total amount of metabolism and heat, so heat's directly related. We actually do, I have a thermal camera to study that heat release. The problem is that the enhanced cerebral blood flow takes away the heat from the brain. And so some people think of the hyperemia associated with metabolic demand as also a radiator for the brain. In other words, to take away the heat so that in vivo, you actually do not see much in the way of heat elevation because of the closed skull and the fact that the blood flow dissipates the heat. But heat is a direct measure of the total mitochondrial ongoing metabolism, yes.
Okay, awesome. All right, our next question asks, is there a predominance of mitochondrial factors over vascular factors to explain metabolic insufficiency?
Well, I think everything kind of adds up. In other words, systemic problems, which, you know, too much blood pressure, too low blood pressure, bad blood vessels in the brain associated with aging from a variety of sources like diabetes, hypertension, either at the large blood vessel or small blood vessel level, and then the reactivity of the blood vessels. And then if the brain needs more glucose already because of aging, then every one of those compromises. So it's kind of a serial factor of which every single one influences, you know, the endpoint, which is how much substrate actually gets into the brain. Now, interestingly, the ketone transport, which is through monocarboxylate transmitters, does not change with aging, unlike the the glucose. Right. And so that's why ketones may work better in Alzheimer's or in stroke, is because those transporters are not changed as much as the glucose transporters.
Okay. Very good. Let's get to this next one. Just curious, which is better source of fuel for long-term brain health? Would you say it's glucose or fat or maybe a combination?
So that's where the ketogenic diet and the intermittent fasting come in. So to be able to liberate, you know, energy from fat, then you need a period of fasting to be able to do that. And we disagree a little bit on how long, but at least 12 to 16 hours of fasting before you release any metabolic substrate. Now, when fat stores start to dissolve to release that substrate, it's always in the form of ketones. Fat stores do not regenerate glucose per se. And so so when we say fat release, we mean ketones then, right? And that's associated with fasting basically. And so at the time of fasting, your blood glucose goes down, your ketones go up because you're being released from fat and from fat stores. And the brain tends to do very well on ketones. Again, with fasting for several days, you're just working on ketones. And a lot of people who have done that, for example, Gandhi, you know, made it very clear that he felt his mental clarity was significantly enhanced after several days of fasting. So in some cultures, it's a tradition to do fasting, you know, to basically to enhance their thinking.
Wow, very interesting. Okay. All right. George said that you mentioned insulin in passing. Are there insulin receptors on neurons or astrocytes that regulate metabolism, or is the metabolic activity independent of insulin? Nasal insulin is being tested for cognitive function.
That's a very good point. So insulin in neurons within the CNS does not mediate metabolism per se. So all of the transporters are separate from insulin, but insulin does stimulate IGF-1 receptors and acts as a growth factor for neurons. To me, it's very unclear where nasal insulin actually goes in the brain, because the distribution studies have not been really well done so far. But the idea is insulin may enhance this IGF factor on brain cells, on neurons, to work as a growth factor, which may enhance cell growth in other ways, much like BDNF, for example, as a growth factor. So there's still a lot of study ongoing with how insulin affects neurons and astrocytes in the brain, but it certainly may be a very positive factor separate from metabolism.
Okay, that was a great response. I think that will be the last question. So I just wanted to say thank you so much for your time and expertise today. And it was such a pleasure to have you with us. And I hope that you enjoyed yourself, Dr. Turner.
Very much. Terrific.